Welcome to this seventh podcast in the series on brain development, mental health, and addiction. The series can be accessed via afmc.ca. Throughout this presentation, we will be hearing from some of the leading experts on brain development and addiction medicine from across Canada and the United States, as well as case studies and personal testimonials from professionals struggling with addiction. The podcast will also include a series of reflective questions that will link the specific learning objectives with the Medical Council of Canada objectives for the qualifying examination related to addiction. The MCC objectives are organized around physicians' roles as defined by the CanMeds and CanMeds FMU competency frameworks for undergraduate medical education. Today's topic will be an introduction to interventions and treatments in children's mental health. We will talk about the importance of level, supportive environments during childhood development, examine the negative consequences of maltreatment that can be experienced throughout life, such as post-traumatic stress disorder, depression, and addiction, and identify treatment options involving healthcare professionals, parents, and children exposed to toxic stress. Children's mental health affects how they socialize, learn, and ultimately meet their potential. Like the levelness of a table, which makes it usable and able to function as it should, the mental health of a child is what enables him or her to function in the world. Some children develop in level environments. They have healthy, supportive relationships and advantages like good nutrition. For others, their brains develop in uneven environments due to exposure to adverse experiences like abuse or addiction in the home. These children often have unreliable or unsupportive relationships and don't have access to key resources. Just like a table, children can't make themselves level. They require attention from those who understand levelness and stability and who can work with them to achieve it. Thus, the foundations of many mental health problems that endure throughout adulthood are established early in life by the quality and stability of a child's human relationships. Dr. Ruth Lanius is a professor of psychiatry at the University of Western Ontario. Here she describes the importance of a secure base in child development and the consequences if this is absent.
And so the core problem with early life trauma, post-traumatic stress disorder, often is that people have difficulties regulating affective arousal. So what they'll often describe is that they're like on an emotional roller coaster. They have very little control over their emotions, and in the morning they may be feeling fine, 2 hours later they may be feeling intensely sad, then an hour later they may have intense irritability and anger and wanting to self-harm, and then, you know, half an hour later they may feel completely numbed out. So what are the origins of these symptoms? And I think a lot more research is coming out now by a variety of labs that is showing that not having a secure attachment, not having that secure base, as Steve Sumi talked about yesterday, may be at the origin of not being able to regulate your emotions. So if we go back to infancy, you know, when a child is upset, when it's hungry, or when its diaper is wet, when it has a secure base, a secure caregiver, that caregiver will then take care of the infant's needs and thereby soothe its nervous system, right? And so over time, the nervous system of the child learns how to calm itself down. However, if you have not had that experience, the nervous system never learns how to do that, right? And so you can get this intense emotion dysregulation. And when people are feeling so dysregulated, when they feel no control over their emotions, I think this can also be directly related to a whole host of other problems. For example, substance abuse. So if you feel completely overwhelmed and if you haven't had any therapy to help you decrease those symptoms, it's very easy to turn to alcohol or drug use in an attempt to regulate those intense emotional states. Also, eating disturbances. Either starving yourself, binge purging, or overeating are often used in an attempt to regulate these intense emotional states. And then, of course, we have chronic characterological changes. Again, if somebody doesn't grow up in an environment where they can learn about trust, appropriate anger management, and really develop a coherent sense of self, how can you have normal characterological development? And then people with chronic trauma also often lose their system of meaning. So again, these symptoms are in an attempt to capture the complexity of response to chronic early life trauma. And if we look at it in terms of comorbidity or psychiatric diagnosis, I think this is what we often see. So people with repeated early life trauma, they have post-traumatic stress disorder, but they also have depression, anxiety disorders, substance use disorders, somatization disorders, eating disorders, dissociative disorders, and sometimes borderline personality disorder. So a very broad, complex response.
One of the tragic outcomes of early childhood maltreatment is the effect it has on sense of self. Many people who have experienced maltreatment or toxic stress as a child have an impaired expression of their self-identity. This can lead to severe problems with forming relationships, interacting effectively in social situations, and succeeding in school and the workplace. Clinical help is available to support those with traumatic experiences. A stage-oriented treatment approach involving emotion regulation, interpersonal effectiveness skills, and prolonged exposure is often effective. Dr. Lanius highlights the importance of early intervention with individuals who have suffered toxic stress.
So what do we need to think about in terms of future directions? I think we need to think about to what extent can interventions that focus on increasing emotional awareness, self-reflection, and the capacity to mentalize modulate stress reactivity and the intergenerational transmission of trauma. And I think we need to go back and think about some of our interventions that are already effective, and these have been discussed by Tom Boyce and Harriet McMillan. You know, can we make these interventions more effective by adding some of these components? And I think we need to keep thinking about identification of high-risk caregivers and how we can intervene earlier and earlier. And I think this symposium really gets us thinking more and more about this, because obviously the earlier we can intervene, the better. However, this is not always possible yet, so I think we also need to think about how can we treat adults with post-traumatic stress disorder related to early life trauma, and how can we not just treat the core post-traumatic stress disorder symptoms, but also the associated self-dysfunction, emotion, and interpersonal dysregulation.
Toxic stress encountered early in life can have an impact on an individual's temperament, including reactive and self-regulatory responses. This involves one's ability to regulate their emotions, such as delaying gratification, controlling impulses, and perseverance. Dr. Heather Henderson, a professor of psychology at the University of Miami, lists the consequences, methods, and benefits of treating this problem.
There's a whole other branch of who we are and what temperament is that is referred to as self-regulation. This, we think, depends on a completely different neural system. It's not amygdala-based, and we also think it has a very different developmental course. So here, John Weiss, later this morning, will be talking about self-regulation as a treatment target in a lot of therapeutic interventions we use right now. Matt talked a lot about the prefrontal cortex and this idea of sort of inhibition and control, and that's exactly what I'm referring to here. I will refer to the exact same study Matt referred to this morning because it is just such a great study. It's the Dunedin longitudinal study, and again, it was a birth cohort of 1,000 kids, everybody that was born within a year, and they have been followed up now to the age 32. And just this year, they published a paper looking at adult outcomes based on childhood temperament and self-control. What they did is they did many different assessments of self-control between the ages of 3 and 10 years of age. They also had indices of IQ and socioeconomic status, which are primary interest variables for a lot of people, but for somebody interested in individual differences, those are just noise to me. So here what they are is we want to control for those and see if there's any contribution over and above these things, if children's individual differences make a contribution over and above. They looked at what happened in adolescence, and they had a great phrase. They talked about adolescent snares, the little blips in development that have long-lasting impacts on development, like starting to smoke, dropping out of high school, and becoming a parent much earlier than planned. So the other nice thing about self-control is there's a lot of data coming out that we can teach this. This is something that we can modify, maybe because the brain systems are more malleable, maybe because it's this prefrontal cortex that we've got this longer window to target and change than we do the more reactive aspects. And these are things that are pretty easy to implement, whether you're a parent, whether you're an educator, whether you're, you know, a grandparent, it doesn't matter. These are pretty easy things that a lot of people do in their everyday life. We can teach strategies for self-control. We can help children learn how to manage their attention in tough situations to facilitate their self-control. We can help them learn how to reframe things cognitively. We can practice self-control in fun ways. Think of classic kids' games. They are teaching self-control. Simon Says, red light, green light. We can provide scaffold experiences. We can teach it. My son Will is 7 and joined the basketball team at school this year in first grade, which is total chaos. But one of my new heroes in the world is Coach Rudy, who coaches the first grade basketball team. And one thing he does when things are really chaotic, when they're trying to have a make a play or do something, is he plays the freeze game. He says, freeze, and every kid stops in whatever position they're in, and they are told to think about what are you doing right now and what is everybody else around you doing. Why is that working? Or most of the time, why is that not working? And let's readjust. And it's a great strategy for helping. Maybe the hardest one is we as adults need to model self-control in our environment, and in our day-to-day interactions, because they are watching.
One of the common sources of toxic stress among children is through maltreatment. It's important to note that maltreatment is an exposure and not a disorder. Educating clinicians, child protection workers, and parents is an effective means of curbing maltreatment and preventing recurrence. Dr. Harriet McMillan, a professor of psychiatry, behavioral neurosciences, and pediatrics at McMaster University, explains.
So now I'm going to move to preventing recurrence of child maltreatment and impairment. And there's a lot we don't know, but we have some good news. Let me just start by saying that maltreatment is an exposure. It's not a disorder. So outcomes are not necessarily exposure specific. As you saw earlier, you get a wide range of problems. And we need to, as we're seeing children who have been exposed, make sure that they're not being exposed again and deal with any impairment that we're seeing. In terms of preventing recurrence of physical abuse and neglect, there is some good news out there. How many of you have heard of the Parent-Child Interaction Therapy Program? Okay, a few people. So this is, again, a very intensive program where there are modules that help parents interact with their children, basically where there's a therapist coaching the person and helping them work together. Has a lot to recommend it, but you have to have motivated parents. Many parents are motivated. I want to be clear, by the way, that we think that the majority of parents do not intentionally set out to harm their children. But when there's a lot of stress and lack of support, this is when maltreatment is more likely. But you'll notice it showed a benefit in reduction of recurrence of physical abuse, but not neglect. And this is a key message.
One successful program in the United States is the Nurse Family Partnership, where specially trained nurses repeatedly visit the home in order to promote health-related behaviors, maternal life course development, and model parental care of children. Dr. McMillan feels this program has benefits that we should incorporate into Canadian programs.
So, what have they found? Well, first of all, improvement in women's prenatal health, reductions in injuries, fewer pregnancies, greater intervals between the birth. They found more fathers involved. The women were often single and poor. They found increases in employment among the women, reductions in welfare, and improvements in school readiness. So look at the broad range of effects of this particular program. What about maltreatment? They found a 48% reduction in state-verified reports. Now remember, I showed you earlier, it's the tip of the iceberg that comes in contact with child protection. It's highly unusual to ever be able to pick up a difference when you're using official reports, and they did, in association with all types of other benefits.
Finally, it's important to note that good mental health produces a positive state of well-being and can be promoted by providing children with nurturing early experiences and environments. High-quality intervention should be a goal of the healthcare system and can help restore good mental health if it becomes disrupted in childhood. Dr. Lanius calls this a path of resilience.
So I just want to go through a diagram that may help us to capture how we can get to a path of resilience versus a path of less resilience. So we've talked a lot about throughout the week about genetic factors and how genetic and maternal environment and maternal care can interact to either lead to a secure or to an insecure attachment. And I think if we have good maternal care and a good maternal environment, that can often be associated with a secure attachment. It can lead to an increased capacity for self-reflection and an increased capacity to mentalize, and is usually associated with increased resilience and decreased probability for intergenerational transmission of trauma. However, if we go back and if we have a poor maternal environment, poor maternal care, an insecure, disorganized attachment, a decreased capacity for self-reflection, or a decreased capacity to mentalize, I think we're often faced with decreased resilience and an increased probability for the intergenerational transmission of trauma.
Indeed, interventions are critical at any age. Dr. Ray Baker is a physician and the medical director of HealthQuest Occupational Health Corporation, an organization in Vancouver specializing in addiction medicine. Dr. Baker has not only treated thousands of people with addiction, he also overcame his own addiction with drugs and alcohol. Here he talks about how easy it would have been to diagnose his addiction to drugs and alcohol early in his medical school years if only someone had asked the right questions.
But the interesting thing is, I don't think I was all that unique in that I was would have been easy to screen, diagnose, and put on the road. If somebody had said, when I was in my late teens or early 20s, said, based on the result of this screening, you should know that this is not okay, that you're at increased risk, and as a matter of fact, I recommend it, or if they made the diagnosis based on the DSM criteria, just in a, and it wouldn't have been hard to do. I lost control. I had significant negative consequences. My life was sort of focused around making sure that I could fit in my alcohol and drug use. And if that were pointed out to me and somebody said, you know, you do meet the criteria for a substance use disorder, for substance dependence, and I strongly recommend that you get some treatment. Mm-hmm. And by the way, Ray, I think you could benefit. I would have jumped at it. I know I would have jumped at it, but nobody did.
So here is a summary of the key points in this podcast. Maltreatment or toxic stress as a child can lead to severe problems with forming relationships, interacting effectively in social situations, and succeeding in school and the workplace. Consequences of toxic stress and its impact on an individual's temperament and ability to regulate their emotions include adolescent failures such as smoking, drinking, drug use, and dropping out of school. This can also lead to serious health problems such as cardiovascular disease and depression later in life. Childhood maltreatment is a predominant form of toxic stress, but can be prevented from occurring and recurring with proper treatment programs. Successful treatment programs such as the Nurse Family Partnership engage and educate both healthcare professionals and families. So as we reach the end of this podcast, here are some reflective questions on the origins of addiction. They are based on the CanMed's competencies and address how you will deal with addiction in your practice. 1. In your role as a medical student or practicing physician, how would you integrate and apply what you've learned about early life experience, especially trauma, toxic stress, and quality of attachment, in engaging with and understanding a patient? How would it change your attitude toward and communication with patients? 2. Are you aware of health services that could address childhood maltreatment in your community? In your position, how could you help your patients access these types of services? 3. How would you organize outpatient care for adult victims of toxic stress and/or those with a history of childhood maltreatment? We hope that you've enjoyed this podcast on interventions and treatments in children's mental health. We welcome your comments in the feedback section at the bottom of this webpage, and we invite you to continue exploring this series as we examine in more detail the core concepts of early childhood development, as well as the types, causes, and treatment of addiction. This podcast series is based on lectures from the Alberta Family Wellness Initiative, a knowledge mobilization initiative designed to translate scientific research into policy and practice. The podcasts were developed by the Association of Faculties of Medicine of Canada with guidance from a project advisory committee and produced by Hugh Kellum and Colin McDonald at the University of Ottawa. Narration was done by Hugh Kellum. This project was sponsored by the Norlene Foundation. The complete podcast series can be accessed via afmc.ca.